हेलो, गुड इवनिंग। दिस इज़ आवर थर्ड सेशन ऑन डेटा स्ट्रक्चर्स सब्जेक्ट। एनी डाउट्स फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस क्लास? इन यस्टरडेज़ क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट एरेज, हाउ टू डिक्लेयर वन डायमेंशनल एरे, हाउ टू इनिशियलाइज वैल्यूज and how to process them using loops, and how to declare a pointer and access array members using pointers. So these things we have discussed yesterday. In today's session we will discuss about structures. Okay, structures, how to declare, why do we need it, and how to access structure members using pointers. If we have enough time, we will see how to handle with functions. Okay, so how to pass, what is a function, we will see, that's it. And how to pass this arrays to functions and structures to functions as it is and using pointers. These things we will learn one by one. As and when required, I'll explain those concepts and we will learn it one by one. Okay, meanwhile, if you have any doubts, you just mention in the chat box, I will reply. And if you have not yet watched the previous two sessions, then links also are mentioned in the description box. You can go through them and subscribe to the channel and also turn on the notification icon. So that's the least help that you can do to us for conducting these sessions. So based on the analytics, like most of the students who are watching the videos haven't subscribed yet. So the number of subscriptions matters to us. So that would be a great help if you subscribe and turn on the notification. So whenever there are live sessions announced, you will get reminders and you can watch them at your convenience. Right. So let's start today's session. So today we will start with structures. So what is a structure? In last class, we have seen what is an array, right? An array is a collection of homogeneous elements. When we say homogeneous elements, it means all the elements are of same type. So, a structure is something which is called heterogeneous, or we can say it is a collection of elements of different types. Collection of elements, or you can say variables of different types. So why do we need a structure is, say if you have an array, I told you, like if you have a list of numbers that you need to store, you are going to declare an integer array. Suppose you have a list of elements to store, but everything is not of the same type. Say for example, you have student data. Now for one student, we store so many data, like say for example, we will have student name, and then we will have students enrollment number or the registration number, we will have the contact number, and then we might have the mail ID, address, and where the student is studying or what they are studying, okay, like education or qualification, or whether they are studying in college or working in a company, whatever. Okay, so all these, so many information you will have to store about one particular person or an object. So when we say an object, in terms of programming language, when we say an object, both living and non-living entities will be called as an object. So what are examples of objects? So we have students, right? Students, employees, these are all living objects, right? Customers, vendors, whatever. And then we have other things also, like classes, batches. Okay, for classes, what all information, etc. For classes, what all information you will store? Class ID, class timings, number of students attending the class, what is the faculty ID, which all students are attending, what is the total duration, all these things you will be storing, right? So it can be, you can even store details about non-living tangible objects, like say about cars, about vehicles, okay, cars, buses or bikes, whatever. And then you can store products like phones, or laptops, right? So there are so many things that you would like to store the details about them, and the details about them falls under different categories. Like name is a character array, enrollment number can be a mixture of characters and numbers, or it can be just numbers also. It all depends. Like your registration numbers are a mixture of character data as well as numeric data, and then contact number is going to be only numeric. Like this, there are different types of information that can be stored. If you're storing marks of a student, it's going to be integer values. If you're storing average of a student, it is a float value. So different types of data are together grouped under one single name, and that is called as a structure. Why do we have to group it? Because all those types belong to one particular object. Like I told you, all this data is related to one student. Every student will have all this data that needs to be stored, isn't it? And then every car has so many features, and all those features belong to that one particular car, isn't it? So when we have different categories or different types of information about one single entity, and you want to group them and call it by one single name, then you can declare structures for such type of data elements. Okay, so what is a structure? It's a collection of elements of different types, or you can say it is a heterogeneous collection of variables belonging to different data types. Now, how do you declare a structure? Declaration of a structure, we will see. I will not write syntax directly, I will write the example. Okay, so please observe the explanation while I'm writing the examples. You have to write struct keyword. Okay, struct is a keyword used to declare a structure, and then give name of the structure. Say I will give name of the structure as student. Okay, so struct is the name of the key, it is a keyword used to define a structure. The student is the name of the structure, and what all features you want to store, all these things you have to define inside this structure. So I will write character name. I'll take a character array of 25 elements. Okay, and then I'll have int roll number, and then I will have int marks. Total marks or something, and then I will have float average. Semicolon. Okay, in the end you write another closing curly braces with semicolon. So this is definition of a structure. So what is this definition? If you have learned C programming already, you will be knowing that structure is a user-defined data type, right? Definition of a structure. So here, a structure, it is a user-defined data type. Means I am defining a new data type as I want, and I can give whatever name I want. Okay, so this is a user-defined data type. What is my user-defined data type now? I am going to define a data type called student. And what is the definition of that data type? It has these four elements in it, and each one has a different type. Okay, so this is definition of a structure. Now, we have not created variables. Remember this. Here I have given name, roll number, marks and average. So all these things are called as structure variables. Okay, structure members, or you can say structure variables. Okay, you can also call them as member variables. Various names you can use. All these member variables, though I have given variable names, they won't be, memory will not be allocated for it. Okay, so when we define a structure, memory is not allotted. I am just informing the compiler that I have defined a new data type in my program, and this is the meaning of that data type. That's it. Okay, next we need to declare object for this structure, that is variables for this structure. For this, how do we define a variable for a structure? We use the name of the data type. name of the data type followed by variable name, right? So I'll give sg1 comma sg2. So what does these things mean here now? This is your name of data type. Observe that the data type name includes struct keyword also and name of the structure also. Together forms the data type name, and these are variables. Okay, this is how we declare variables, right? So if I want two variables, int a comma b. So this is data type name, these are the variables. So when I declare a variable, memory is allotted, isn't it? A, 2 bytes of memory is allotted, and for b also 2 bytes of memory is allotted. Similarly, here data type name is struct student, and I have declared two variables sg1 and sg2. So now memory is allotted for it. Now we know what is the data type sizes: character 1 byte, int 2, float 4 and double 8. Now since this is also a data type, what is the size of this data type? It is the sum of all the variables that are present in this structure definition. Okay, because if I am defining a structure, it is supposed to include all this data, isn't it? Therefore, size of a structure variable or size of a structure data type is same as the sum of sizes of all the variables that are present in that particular structure. Now, what is the size here totally? This requires 25 bytes, right? Every character array needs 1 byte, and this is a character array with 25 characters. Therefore, it requires 25 bytes. This is roll number, which requires 2 bytes. This is one integer variable, which requires 2 bytes. This is a float variable, which requires 4 bytes. Okay, so totally you have 4 plus 2, 6 plus 2, 8 plus 25 is 33 bytes. So what is the memory requirement for this particular structure? It is 33 bytes of memory is required. Now, I have declared two variables sg1 and sg2 of this type. So each one requires 33 bytes. How is the memory allotted? We will see. Here, 33 bytes of memory will be allotted for sg1 and 33 bytes of memory is allotted for sg2 as well. Okay, now what all things are present in this structure? First is name 25. Therefore, first 25 bytes are going to be for name. Clear? And you know, since it's an array, it always starts from 0. So 0, 1, 2 up to 24. So this entire thing is called as name. Okay, first 25 bytes, it's called as name. Next is int roll number. So the next 2 bytes, that is this 25 and 26, these locations are occupied by the variable roll number. Okay, next 2 bytes are occupied by the variable marks, because that is also int. And next 4 bytes is required for average. 1, 2, 3 and 4. Okay, so this 4 bytes are required for average. Because it is float, it requires 4 bytes. Hope you are clear with this. Total 32 bytes of memory is allotted in this case. And first one is going to be for name, because the first name given here is this name. Next we have given roll number, therefore roll number memory is allotted. Next is marks and next is average. Based on the data type, that many number of bytes are allotted. And indexing, see, I have not written 25, 26, 27 here, right? So it is 33 bytes, means it is from 0 to 32. And if you have observed, after 24, I have not written 25, 26 up to 33, because indexing is not present for non-array elements. Okay, this index numbers, this 0, 1, 2, this index numbers are present only for arrays, not for non-array variables. Here, roll number, marks, average, these three are individual values. They're not arrays. Only this name is an array with 25 elements. So these 0, 1, 2 up to 24, these are index variables of the variable name. which is inside st1 structure variable. Is that clear? Now this many values are present. In the same way for st2 also, this much is called name and this is roll number and this is marks and this is average. Okay, so every variable will have its own copy of name, roll number, marks and average. Hope this is clear. So now, as I told you, all this data belongs to one particular object, right? All this data belongs to one, every student. So I have declared variable for two students here. So this set of data, one set of data belongs to student 1, another set of data belongs to student 2. Now we have declared the memory, how to access them or how to find out what all values are stored in each variable. We will make use of two ways. There are two ways to store the values into it. One is using normal structure variable. One more is using pointer to a structure. So first we will see how to access individual elements belonging to structure. Okay, accessing structure members. Accessing members of a structure. Okay, so to access members of a structure, you can directly assign it with variable name dot object name dot variable name. Okay, so that is, we can give st1 dot name equals to hello. So what type of initialization is this called? So this is static initialization, which is assigning a value to a member variable within the code itself. If you want to do dynamic initialization, that is during runtime, if you want to provide values for the structure's members, then we use scanf statement. In scanf, I'll use %d. Twice I will give, okay. That is, I will read two values. And where am I supposed to store? I am supposed to store it in the roll number. Okay. And you know that roll number is there for each and every structure variable, right? Roll number is not an independent variable. It belongs to a structure variable. And you know that there are two roll numbers here. One belongs to st1, one belongs to st2. In which roll number you need to store? So that you need to mention clearly. So it is st1 dot roll number, and never forget to give the ampersand symbol. So the value that is read here is stored in the address of st1 dot roll number, and the next one is stored in the address of st1 dot marks. Okay, so this is how you accept input for the structure's members during execution time. Okay, this is accessing members of a structure using a variable of the structure with dot operator. So if you are using them in for loop, or if you are printing them in printf statement, everywhere you are going to use st1 dot roll number, st1 dot marks, st1 dot average, like that only you will be using. So this is accessing members of a structure using the standard input functions. Now within this structure also you might have arrays. Okay, that is possible. In this example, we don't have, though character array is present, we will not be accessing them character by character. We will handle it like a string, right? But if you have marks is present. If this marks is again an array and then we need to calculate its average. So in such cases, you will have array within a structure. Okay. Array inside a structure. So what does this mean is, we have defined a structure which has some arrays also inside it. Now we had a character array, but again, as I told you, this character, we are not treating it as a character array. It is used to store one individual value only, like one name of every student is stored there. We don't have multiple data elements there, isn't it? So if you have an array inside a structure, we will see how to access them. Say for example, in that same structure example, I will be writing one array inside that structure, okay, like this struct student character name 25. So though it is an array, we are not going to access individual elements of it. It will be treated as one string. Then we have int roll number. Next I have int marks. Let me take marks of 5 subjects. Okay. From this marks, I am going to calculate average. This is one example for structure. Now, can you tell me what will be the total number of bytes required for this data type? So here this requires 25 bytes, this is 2 bytes. This is an integer array, integer value requires 2 bytes and it's an array of 5 elements which requires 10 bytes. Okay, every value requires 2 bytes, so we have 5 values, so it requires 10 bytes. And then we have a float data type which requires 4 bytes again. So it is 41 bytes of memory will be required for variables that belong to this particular structure. Okay, now here I am going to give input for these three things. For this input, the value should be calculated by itself using marks of marks array. So to store values now for this, I told you can use scanf statement and we can store the values. So see, I'm not giving you complete program now. All these things I'll combine and I'll give you as one single program. So now suppose we want the user to enter the values. Now how will you write the code for this? Name to store the name, you can use getS. Difference between scanf percentage s and getS you will learn soon. st1.name, this is to read a string, read a line of input. One full line is stored as a string. Okay, so we are going to enter some name that is stored in the variable name. And how to store that, you have to mention st1.name. Okay, next is roll number. For roll number, how do you accept the value? You will ask the user to enter roll number. Since it's an integer value, you will write percentage d ampersand st1. There is no space here. Okay, so it is st1.rollNumber. Next we need marks for all 5 subjects, right? So 5 different marks we need. So we will write a for loop for this. For, I told you always array starts from 0. So we will write for I equals to 0. I less than 5 we should take. Okay. And then I plus plus. And I will be reading one value, integer value. Where is that supposed to be stored? st1.marks. One by one, I need to store from 0 to 4, which is stored in the variable I, right? Ampersand. Understood? Now here how the values are stored, we will read one value and we are storing it in st1.marks0. Next when I gets increased, I will read one more value, I will accept one more value from the input stream, and then it is stored in marks1, next in marks2. Okay, like that we will store the values from, we will store 5 values from marks0 to marks4 belonging to st1. Okay, now I told you that indexing will be present only for arrays, right? So here how the memory is allotted, we will see. Here again, the first 0, 1, 2 up to 24. This belongs to name. Then I have 2 bytes. This belongs to roll number. After that, there are 10 bytes for marks, right? Because it is an array of 5 elements. So we have 10 bytes wherein we have 0, 1. This is mark 0. This is marks 1 because 2 bytes are required. Okay, so this is one value, this is a second value, third value, so from 0. So this is entirely called as marks. Understood? So ST1 dot marks 0 is this area. ST1 dot marks dot 1 is this area. 2 bytes are stored for each value. Okay, so we have to mention the variable name dot array name with the subscript. This is how you can access array within a structure. Okay, so here we are using array as a member of a structure. Hope this is clear. And to store values, like now I need to find the average also, right? We need to find the average marks that is present in ST. For this, what we have to do is write down sum also here itself. Sum equals to, or sum plus equals to ST1 dot marks I. Store every value, add it to sum. So when you come out of the loop, sum is a variable which stores at values of all the variables added up, right? Now next we will find average value by giving ST1.average equals to sum divided by 5.0. So why 5.0? Why not 5? You will understand clearly if you follow the C programming videos. So this is how you store the values and you access them for members of a structure. Okay. Next we will see how to define array of structures. Array within a structure we have just seen. What is array of structures? That is, right now I have given 2 variables only, ST1 and ST2. Means first one is for student 1's details and then ST2 is details of student 2. Suppose I have 100 students, then I cannot give ST1, ST2, ST3 up to 100, isn't it? So we can create, just like any other data type, we can create an array for structure data type also. So if I have only one value to store, I will write like this. If I have 10 values of the same type to be stored, then I can write like this, isn't it? Similarly, if I have a structure variable, only one variable or 2 variables, I gave like this. But if I have more variables or more students' data, then I can't keep giving letters or names. Instead, I will mention here itself as 50. So here I am creating enough memory to hold the records of 50 students. Okay, hope this is clear. So this is called as array of structures. So if you have array of structures, then how can you access, or how memory is allotted, we'll see. If you know how memory is allotted, then you will know how it can be accessed as well. So you know that every let me write one example here. So I will write struct student ST10. So it has it is an array. ST is an array which is of type structure student, and it can store details of 10 students. Now that every value requires 41 bytes, right? As per our previous example, we want 41 bytes to store each student's record. And how many students' record am I storing? 10 students' record. So what is the total memory allotted here? It is 41 bytes into 10 elements, which is 410 bytes of memory is required for this ST. So observe how the memory is allotted. Now this entire thing is ST, and you see 41 bytes is for ST one, right? I mean first student. So it's going to be 0, 1, 2 or first 41 bytes. Okay, this is 41 bytes. This is for 0. ST0 means first student's details. For ST1, that is second student's details, again 41 bytes are allotted. And again for index number 2, which is third student's details, 41 bytes is allotted. Like this, for all 10 students, 41 bytes are allotted, which makes it a total of 410 bytes of memory. Now in this 41 bytes we have a copy of all the variables that we defined inside the structure. Like we have name here. For name we have 0, 1, 2 up to 24. Then we have roll number. Then we have marks. Okay, so this is roll number. Suppose this is roll number. Now marks has 5 elements, right? This is also an array. So for that, again indexing will be done. What is that indexing? It is 0, 1, 2, 3. Okay, 4. So marks is an array of 5 elements which has marks 0, marks 1 up to marks 4. So I have written marks with index numbers 0 to 4. So this is how the memory is allotted inside a array of structures. Okay, so this entire thing is for first student's details because it is ST0. This name, roll number, marks, everything belongs to ST0. Okay, now similarly all these values are going to be present here again. Okay, name, roll number, marks is present for this, and here again you have name, roll number, marks. Okay, so every and average also, sorry, we haven't written average, so even average is also considered here, but we are giving values for only the first three variables, name, roll number and marks. Average value is calculated as it is using this instruction, and here we will have average value as well. Hope this is clear. Now this is array inside structure, I mean array of structure. So we have seen how to declare array inside a structure and how to declare an array of structures. Okay, now let us see a sample program for implementing a structure with arrays. Okay, I use DevC++ for typing. It has an inbuilt editor as well as compiler. So you know what is a compiler. It converts your source code to machine understandable format. You can use any of the C compiler. You have DevC++, you have Visual Studio Code, and then we have Turbo C++. Any of the C compilers you can use. You can even use online compilers for executing the, for practicing the programs. So right now we have a demonstration of array of structures here. So observe the program. I will share this program also with you for your reference. So you don't have to write down, just observe it. We have included a header file. You know, standard input output file has the standard input output functions like printf, scanf, gets and all that. I have first defined the structure. Okay, this should come before main function. So we have defined a structure with all the necessary members of it and end it with a semicolon. So that completes structure definition. So we have roll number, name, which is a string, and then an integer array with 5 marks and then float. Okay, next in the main function, first we have declared variables. So first I have declared an array of 10 elements for the structure. So struct student st 10. So st is name of the array and we have 10 elements here. And we have some integer variables here to store various index numbers. Like since we have two arrays here, one is a structure array and one is an integer array inside the structure, we need two variables for iterating it in a for loop. And then n is number of students and sum is a variable used to add all the subjects. Then after dividing only, you will get average. Okay. Now I am asking the user to enter how many students details the user wants to give. And whatever the user enters is stored in a variable called n. Why do we need this n? I have declared an array of 10 students. Every time to test the program, I can't enter 10 students details, right? So we have declared an array for 10 students, but then we are not using all the spaces. Every time we are asking the user to enter how many students details they want to enter. Accordingly, we are going to run the loop that many number of times. Okay. So therefore, the same set of instructions should be repeated n times. Hence, we are using a for loop here. I have started from I equals to 0 because you know that since the student array, it has 10 elements. It starts from ST0 up to ST9. So, first student's details will be stored in ST0. Second student's details is supposed to be in ST1, right? So, from I equals to 0 up to I less than N, we are going to store the details of the student, okay? Here, first we ask the user to enter student name. And whatever name is entered, it is stored in sti.name. So what is the value of I now? Since I is 0, sti.name indicates that name, it is the name of the first student. And this we will be discussing later also, even in the C programming video. If you are reading a string, then you are going to use %s in the scanf statement and you are not supposed to use ampersand symbol here. If it is an integer value, only for that you need ampersand, and for strings we don't need ampersand. We have to just mention the string name. Okay. So scanf %s sti.name. Next we are asking the user to enter roll number, and the value that is entered is stored in sti.rollNumber. And don't forget to put this ampersand symbol. Okay. Next, we need 5 subjects. For this, you know that marks is again an array, right? So we need one more loop here to store values from marks 0 to marks 4. Therefore, I have used one more loop here with another variable, a different variable. I have started from j equals to 0 and up to j less than 5, means it will take values up to 4. And we are reading each value, every integer value, we take it as input. Where am I storing? It is in sti.marksj. So you have to understand what this mean. I is 0. Okay, so ST0 in the sense it is first student's details. In that, marks J is taking values from 0 to 4. So I am storing first value in marks 0, then marks 1, then marks 2, like that up to marks 4. So all this belongs to ST0, right? Which is for first student, I am storing 5 marks. And every time I accept the marks, I am adding it to a variable called sum to store all the marks of that particular student. As soon as we come out of the loop, that is once we read 5 different marks of this student, we are finding average. Okay, so sti.average, that is average variable belonging to the first student. In that, I need to store a value which is sum divided by 5. This sum, this variable has the sum of all the students, sum of all marks of this first student. I divide it by 5.0 and that answer I am storing it in AVG, which is the average variable. Now we have collected details of the first student and we have calculated the average marks for the first student. Okay, it is done. Next, I++. So I becomes 1. When I becomes 1, I is less than whatever number we have given is going to be true. Now this entire procedure now is repeated with I equals to 1. When I is 1, it refers to second student. Okay. So student name we are storing in ST1.name, ST1.rollNumber, and here j will start again from 0 to 4, but where are these marks stored? Marks 0, marks 1, marks 2 belonging to ST1. Clear? Hope you can understand this well. So I told you this is ST0, right? ST0, this is first student, right? So for first student, I stored marks 0, marks 1, marks 2, marks 3 and marks 4. And I used these marks to calculate average and I stored that here. Okay, here we stored the average marks. Similarly, next when this is I, right? Next when I becomes 1, it means it is the second student's details. Now, whatever value I am collecting and I am storing, it's going to be stored here. So ST1.name, ST1.rollNumber, ST1.marks. In this ST1.marks, again we have 5 marks. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? So marks 0, marks 1, marks 2 belonging to ST1, which is second student. Then I am again giving STI.AVG. So I is 1. So I am referring to AVG belonging to the second student. Here I am giving again sum divided by 5.0. So sum of all these marks divided by 5 is going to be the average marks for the second student. Like this, we are going to repeat this procedure n times to store n students' details. Okay, that is this for loop. After that, we are going to display the results of the student using another for loop. See, for this I have given student results and these are the headings that are given. For I equals to 0, I less than n, I am displaying only roll number, name and average. Okay, hope this is clear. I will compile this one. Right now I don't know, even if it is a little confusing or very fast for you, I'm actually giving a quick revision of these topics. So I'm actually explaining it very fast, but when we start writing programs, I'll be explaining you how to write the code line by line, okay, for the data structure programs. Right now this program actually belongs to C programming and I'm giving a quick revision of this, hence I'm explaining it fast. The same program will be explained in detail slowly under C programming syllabus in those videos. So if you have already practiced C programming very well, you will be able to understand what I am saying now. So whatever so far in the past 10-15 minutes, my explanation of this program, if you have felt it is very fast, then it means that you don't have enough practice in C programming. So make sure you watch all my C programming videos. It will be done very slowly in detail. Okay. Right now I have compiled it. I will run the program. I am executing it. I will give 3. Okay. Means I am going to enter details for 3 students. Okay. So enter details of student 1. Now the program is asking me to enter name of the student. I have given name of the student as ABC. Roll number I will give 120. And we have to enter marks of 5 subjects. Okay. So I'll give 24, 26, 28, 29. Assuming it is for 30. I have given 5 marks here. That's it. It is not showing me average. I'm just collecting the information. So first student's name, roll number and marks is collected. Now I have to give name for the second student. I give PQR. And roll number I'll give 125 and we have to enter marks of 5 subjects. I'll give 21, 23, 22, 24 and 20. Next, enter details for student 3. For student 3 I'll give name as XYZ, roll number is 128 and marks 26, 29, 30, 20, 22. 5 marks is over. Yes. Okay. So see, now I have a summary of all the details, student results. Okay. You can see the star and the heading, that is what is present here. No, the same thing. we have roll number slash t name slash t average, so that is your heading here, roll number, name and average. Below that we have one integer value which is of sti.rollNumber. Okay, for st0 roll number is 120, st0.name is abg, abc, st0.average is this 26.4. okay, next when I becomes 1, it displays roll number, name and average for second student, roll number, name and average for third student. Is that clear? This is array of structures. Okay, we have a structure, inside the structure also we have an array, and we have also declared an array for the structures. So basically I have stored, I have created a program which can process 10 students' marks details, and it will calculate and show the result of their grade average marks. Okay, now that is about accessing structure elements using structure variables and dot operator. So next thing you have to know is accessing structure variables or members of the structure using pointers. Okay, so when we are accessing a structure variable using pointer, then we would have declared structure variables. We have dynamic memory location wherein without declaring structure variables you can directly allocate memory and assign it to pointers, but that we will see later after a couple of classes. Right now we will assume we have a variable, structure variable. We are going to store its address to a pointer, and then we will access members of the structure using pointer. We will do slight modifications in that existing program which I just explained to you. We will do slight modifications with it, and then we will write detailed programs in the upcoming classes. So how to declare a pointer? You know how to declare a pointer. We just have to give data type name star and the pointer name. So here we had already declared structure variables, right? We had given struct student st1, st2, right? Now I am declaring a pointer also. Here itself you can give star ptr. You can give any name. I have given ptr. Ptr is a pointer variable of structure type. Now you have to remember how many bytes are required in this case. Let us assume that second example that we had taken, we require 41 bytes, right? So 41 bytes are required for st1, 41 bytes are required for st2. For pointer variable, how many bytes are required? Yesterday I told whatever is the data type of pointer variable, it is going to store address locations only, which are unsigned integers and which always requires 2 bytes. So this is another important question for placements and all that. So you should know whatever is the data type, a pointer variable always needs 2 bytes because it stores only address. It doesn't have the actual values. It will store only address of locations which has actual values. So irrespective of data type that is stored in the actual locations, the memory addresses are always unsigned integers which requires 2 bytes of memory. Okay, now how to access these members? You know, by using st1.name, st1.rollNumber, st1.marks, you have assigned the values to it. Now to access the members, so basically let us assume we had an example here, no, st1, right? We have, okay, so st1 and st2. This is st1, this is st2. Memory is allotted like this. Let me assume st1's memory starts at 1200, location number 1200. st2's memory location starts at 2000. Let us assume, okay. Now, I have star ptr. This requires only 2 bytes. Clear? How to assign address of a variable to a pointer? You have to use ampersand symbol to assign the address of a variable to a pointer. So we need to write code like this, ptr equals to ampersand st1. Okay, ptr equals to ampersand st1, it means address of this variable st1. Whenever we have a memory block, so here we have a block of 41 bytes of memory, but whenever we refer to address of a memory block, it refers to the beginning address, starting location. Okay, so what is stored in ptr? We have 1200 that is stored in ptr, because that is the starting memory location, so that is stored in ptr. Now this is how we assign address of a structure to a pointer, and using this pointer we can access all these members using arrow operator. Okay, this is called as arrow operator. There is no separate symbol for this. You have to actually type a hyphen and the greater than symbol to get this arrow operator. Now ptr refers to the memory block. This entire thing is a memory block. Okay, not just this one memory, this entire thing is memory block. It starts at 1200. In this memory block, we have various components. We have name, we have roll number, marks, average and all this. So to access each and every individual component member of that memory block, we will use pointer name with the arrow operator. So in the printf statement, instead of giving st1.rollNumber, st1.marks, we are going to give ptr arrow roll number. Okay, ptr arrow marks. If marks is an array, then you will give like this, marks 1, marks 2, or simply marks I. Okay, hope this is clear. This is if you are referring to individual structure variables. Okay, but here later, okay, after printing all this, now you have to access the second structure, second student's detail also using the same pointer. You can do it. You will have to give ptr equals to ampersand st2. Okay, when you give like this, now what is st2's address? 2000, that is stored in this value, so previous value gets replaced. Now after giving this instruction, now if you refer to ptr roll number, it refers to the roll number belonging to the memory block that starts at 2000. Okay, so ptr refers to memory block 2000. In this we have a roll number, which is this one. Hope this is clear. This is accessing individual structures memory at locations, I mean individual structures members using a pointer. Now if you have an array, in the previous class I told you, when you add a number to a pointer, it refers to next value of that same type. So suppose we have an integer pointer, then if you have p, then p plus 1 actually adds p plus 2 bytes. Okay, so if we write p plus 2, it adds p plus 2 into 2 bytes. Why? Because integers requires 2 bytes of memory, right? So when I say p plus 1, whatever address p is having, p is a pointer, whatever address p has, plus 1 value. So that next value is after 2 bytes because it is an int. If it is float, then the same p plus 1 means it is p plus 1 into 4 bytes. Because it is a float value, the next value is after 4 bytes. Okay, so if I write p plus 2, it means p plus 2 into 4 bytes. So after 8 bytes, we have the third value. It is like that. So because it is float value, 4 bytes represent one value, right? So when we say next second value, it means you have to proceed 8 bytes further. Similarly, if it is a structure, then when I add 1, actually 41 bytes gets added. If I add 2, then 2 times 41 bytes gets added. Therefore, if you have declared an array, like this, st10, and then we have a pointer as well, then To assign address of the array to pointer, I have told you no need of ampersand symbol and no need of index number. We have to just give the array name. Remember this assignment, okay? If you have int x and star p, to store address of x into p, we have to give ampersand symbol. Suppose I have int y and star q. It means I am storing address of an array to a pointer, then I have to give only y. What does this mean? This is same as storing address of first element of the array to q. Okay, same as that. So whenever we store address of an array to a pointer, we should not use this ampersand symbol and no need of index variable. We have to just give name of the array. Similarly, for structure variables also, structure array also, I have given ptr is equal to st. Okay, so st 10 is there, it has 10 elements. When I give st, it is same as ampersand st 0, means address of first student's memory. Okay. So we'll give ptr equals to st. Now, as I told you, if this location starts at 1200, then the second student's details starts after 41 bytes, which is 1241. The next student's details starts at 1282. Okay. Now, when I write ptr equals to st, then in ptr, what value gets stored? 1200. Okay, when I write ptr plus 1, it becomes 1241. Ptr plus 1 value means it is go to the next value. Next value is after 41 bytes because ptr is of type structure. Okay, so hope this is clear. I will make slight modifications to this structure so that you will understand, so that we can access the members using the pointer. So I'll give star ptr. Okay, so I have a structure, I have a pointer of type structure. This half of the program remains same. We are asking the user to enter number of students and then we are writing a for loop to store details of that many number of students. Next, we have stored average, everything is done. Now we are supposed to display the answer. To display the answer, just before displaying the answer, we assign array to the pointer. See, if you observe, I have not given ampersand or the index value. I have just given ptr equals to st. It means address of first student's record is stored in ptr. Okay. Now, while I need to print, I am going to give ptr plus I. Okay. And arrow operator. When I is 0, ptr plus 0 refers to just ptr only. Okay. Ptr plus I. And we need to change this to arrow operator. Okay. So, ptr refers to address of the first location. When I is 0, ptr plus 0 is going to be ptr only. So we will get a roll number, name and average of the first student. Next, I becomes 1. When I becomes 1, ptr plus I means it will be 1200 plus 41 bytes. Okay. So it refers to roll number, name and average belongs to the location that starts from 1241. So like this, we are going to print the values of all the students. With that ptr, we are accessing the entire array just by incrementing the pointer. Okay, so let's execute this. Number of students, again, I'll give Asha roll number 120. Marks I'll give, now this time I'll give for 40 marks, 45, 49, 40, I mean for 50 marks basically, 38 and then 43, 5 subjects over, yes. Enter details of student 2, I'll give my name itself, so 129 and 5 subjects marks. I'm going to give more marks to myself, 49 and 50, 5 subjects marks done. Now we have another name. My students know why I write this name. This is my daughter's name. I write this name. Rule number 130. And we are going to have 5 subjects marks. And she is supposed to score more than me. So all more marks only. Okay, done. So now we have the same output, same program only. But instead of accessing it directly, we have accessed it using a pointer. And how to access the subsequent elements of an array of structures using pointer, I have explained. So yesterday, I think Saloni asked me that if all pointers require 2 bytes, why does a pointer require data type, right? I had, she has asked me in the chat box. So this is the reason why we need to give data type. When I write PTR plus 1, how many bytes actually it increases depends on the data type it is referring to. If it is an integer data type, the next value is after 2 bytes. If it is a float data type, next value is after 4 bytes. If it is a structure variable like this, the next value is after whatever is the structure's data type size. Okay, that is the reason we have to give data type for a pointer. But all pointer variables will require 2 bytes for storage. But why do we give data type? Is this is called pointer arithmetic. Okay, so when we do pointer arithmetic, when we increase or when we decrement or when we increment, the compiler should know how many bytes it has to decrease and increase. Okay, hope this is clear. Any doubts? I know the session is like quite fast. I myself feel that it is fast. So if you have not understood, this video is going to be accessible in the channel. So later also you can play it again and you can try to understand it. But it is fast because it is a revision. Next class, this much information is sufficient. We are going to use functions also, but that we will discuss slowly one by one. Okay. Any doubts, please let me know if you have any doubts. I will reply in the chat box. Also provide your feedback in the comment section. Okay, so in the next class, we will see how to implement stacks using arrays and then also using pointers. So we'll see how it is done. And then we'll slowly build it up to cover the entire list. I will take a class probably on Wednesday or Thursday evening, so that because we do only weekly 2 days, I don't know whether we might be able to finish the syllabus before your exams. So we will have a little more classes, that is weekly 3 classes is more than sufficient. And we will take it very slow and in detail from the next class, because so far what I have done is we have seen an introduction overview of the subject, and we have seen we have done a quick revision of C programming topics required for data structures. We have not actually started the data structure topics. Okay. There will be many programs required, okay, small programs will be required, and for you to practice, and those programs I will be uploading regularly, and I'll be sharing the links in the WhatsApp group. So just have a look at them to understand how we can manipulate the working of the program by doing small changes in the loops, and how arrays or pointers, how all these things varies. For that, small changes will give you a different type of output, and then how to detect errors and what does each type of error means. So for all these things, I will have a small video, like a 10 minutes, 15 minutes videos. Those videos are not going to be like live classes. Those I will upload as and when those are ready. So I suggest you to go through all those things to have a very good in-depth knowledge of the subject. Okay, the last 2 minutes, let me know if you have any doubts, any clarifications. and mention your feedback, mention your suggestions in the comment section. So when the comments are more, YouTube algorithm will show it in the top search results when other students are searching for this topic. This videos will come up in the search results if it has more user engagement. Means it needs to have, you know, more comments and interactions. So your comments will help me help this video to reach more students. Okay, fine. We will end the session for today. And meanwhile, I'll be sharing some notes also in a WhatsApp group. If you have not yet joined any of the groups, if you don't want to join WhatsApp group, you can also join the Telegram channel, wherein your identity is going to be private, like your numbers nobody can take. So you can join in the Telegram channel and you can see all the previously uploaded notes, videos also. Okay, so the links are mentioned in the description. Okay, see you all. Happy weekend. See you in the next class. Bye-bye.